There is a place that is spoken about only in whispers. A dark area that spawns the beginnings of urban legends. A place where anything can happen, and usually does. During the light of day, it hides just outside of view. But when the sun goes down, spirits, creatures of the night, roam free, and things do go bump in the night. It is in every state and every country, and there is no escaping it, no matter how safe you feel behind your locked doors and latched windows. So we invite you to turn down the lights and turn up your radio while we join Dave Schrader and Tim Dennis, your hosts, on a journey into the darkness on the edge of town.
Good evening and welcome back to Hour 2 of the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. This crazy, creepy, Halloween-y type night. We're getting ready for Halloween not too far off here, Tim. Did you get all the candy ready for the kids?
I ate it all.
Oh, good boy.
And you said Halloween-y.
You're such a freak. Our guests tonight are Denice Jones. She's the founder of the Life Foundation, which is a place for you to go if you're having paranormal problems and you need help. As a matter of fact, that's how you can find her at paranormalhelp.com. And Denice is the mother of, and boy, what a mother, Tim was saying during the break. She's a good mother. She's been working with kids that most of us probably would have been done with, the minute they said, Mom, I see dead people. But she's been been amazing with what she's been able to do. She's got two sons that are gifted. One son is incredibly gifted and has actually, in a sense, was the inspiration for the character of Cole Sear in M. Night Shyamalan's movie, The Sixth Sense. And she's here sharing her story with us about the trials and tribulations that she had to go through with her son over all these years. And also coming up on the show with us here is John Zaffis. He's a paranormal investigator and has worked very closely with Denice on this case. So it's been, just an amazing story. If you missed the first hour, you're going to definitely have to make sure to download it and listen to it tomorrow. It will be available up on our site. And, if you want to chat during this, we do have a live chat that's available. Just go onto our website at darknessradio.com, click on the listen, and there's a link right there to take you into the chat room. Or you can actually click on the discuss tab on our website, and we have a bulletin board there. You can go in there, and quite a few of the people get on boards and chat during the show there, so you can talk and share with other people involved in the paranormal. Now getting back into the show for this evening, as I mentioned, we have Denice and John on the line with us. Thank you very much for sticking with us here for hour two.
Not a problem.
All right, so we've got this going on. You've had it. Now you're doing another exorcism, John, for Michael. I keep wanting to call him Cole. For Michael, and you do this, and then how do things progress after the second exorcism?
Basically, things calm down as far as some of the negative things that are occurring. But I knew at that point in time that we were just putting a Band-Aid on the situation to try and relieve some of the things that were occurring with him on the negative end of that.
Now, at any point, is it crossing Denice your mind or John your mind to actually just try to close down these abilities of Michael's?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I mean,
oh, you wanted to close them off altogether so he's not seeing dead people at all. Okay. All right.
You know, Denice many a times would say to me, John, can't we just get this to stop? Can't we shut them off? Isn't there something that can be done, you know, basically at that point in time to shut everything down? And, you know, it's a difficult type thing.
Yeah, you can't do it. Michael can't. He can't shut down. He's on 24 hours a day. And that's just the way it's going to be for him. I kind of gave up hoping it would shut down a long time ago.
Wow.
And so is he. And it's his life. This is all he's used to. I think he would be confused if he didn't see dead people. Like one day he was sitting, I'll never forget this, he's sitting on the couch next to me, and he has his arm up in the air, and he just keeps putting it down and up, and down and up, and I'm trying to watch TV, and I look at him, I said, what are you doing, Michael? He says, I'm looking at my energy. I said, what do you mean? He goes, Mom, just put your arm up and put it down. And I did, and he says, see? And I'm like, Michael, what are you talking about? He says, Mom, you put your arm up, put it down. He says, don't you see your arm still there going down slow in the colors? And I'm looking at him.
Tim used to have that with acid during college.
Yeah, I did that in college all the time.
And I'm like, no, Michael. Well, he was very upset because he thought everybody can do this. He never knew that he could only do this.
So can he see auras? Is that what he's seeing, or is he seeing the energy field? What exactly is he seeing?
Actually,
maybe it's easier. What can't this kid do?
Well, see, that's the thing, and that's the problem we have with Michael. When I went and spoke to John Holland, and we talked for quite a while, I went to New Hampshire and visited him. He says, Michael is very unique. He seems to have all the gifts, and they're all coming at the same time. And this is where his problem is because, you know, when you're a psychic medium and clairvoyant, clairaudient, and you astral travel and you have visions, you just can't pick one and say, okay, I'll work with this one because another one's jumping in at the same time. And this is where Michael's having a problem.
Okay. So it's just, he's just like overloaded with abilities.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, that's unbelievable. Okay, so now you've got this going. You put the Band-Aid on, do this one exorcism to try to get things going. How long till things start going horribly wrong again?
How long was it, Denice?
After the second exorcism?
Mm-hmm.
I think he might have had a month.
So it was about a month before things started getting ugly?
Yeah, I think it was a month for the second one. Then it was a longer time for the third.
But these are the types of things, Dave, here again, it did not surprise me. But when being an investigator, it's one of the most difficult things to try to explain to a parent what the child is going through. And that he has several different perspectives on the paranormal level. So he was getting whammied all the way around, and I was able to understand it. I knew what the child was going through, but it's one of the hardest things in the world to sit there and tell Michael's mom, you have to learn to sift through some of this, and this is going to take a little bit of time because Michael can't shut down.
Well, my problem with the whole thing was I could help other families. They were coming to me for help through the foundation, and I would send them a paranormal investigator to help them. They would be helped, but I couldn't help my own son.
Wow.
You know, and then I had to realize, okay, Michael has gifts. Some of these other homes, okay, maybe it's their house that's haunted, or there's just something attached to somewhere in that home or whatnot. They can get rid of it, or they can do something. It might not necessarily be the child or the adult that's haunted, like Michael. And that's where I had to understand and try to go on with my life. And
okay.
Michael had to go on with his.
So you do the, now a third exorcism is called in, John. Are you called in for this third one as well?
Yes.
Okay.
That was where a decision was made where Bishop McKenna was brought in, Robert McKenna.
Okay.
And I will be quite frank and honest with you, Denice did not want to go forth with it. And I understood why.
Why,
but
Denice? What was holding you off at that point?
Go ahead, Denice.
I don't know why. I don't know.
Okay.
Okay.
When these things go on, Dave, and these things occur, people, they get used to the fact of the activity occurring.
Okay.
And the different things that multiply things, and it makes it worse because it's masking itself and it's burying itself underneath. And I went forth and I said, okay, fine, we're going to do this. And I had that gut-wrenching feeling that it needed to be done due to the fact of a few things that were occurring on a paranormal level with Michael. So the exorcism was performed, and it was done. Now, there was a difference to me after the last exorcism was performed with the circumstances, the surrounding area within the house and with Michael. Now, Dave, another thing you have to remember is the fact that not just Michael, but most people that do pick up on spirit, and legitimate type spirit, they will tell you they don't like it. They don't want anything to do with it. Michael used to tell me that all the time. He goes, John, please just make them all go away. I don't want nothing to do with it. That little boy used to say that all the time.
Yeah, I bet.
So, you know, when a child or an adult says something to me like that, and they're not able to basically shut themselves down, that's torture. That is pure torture.
I would guess.
Yeah, I used to cry a lot for Michael.
Right. Yeah, I can, as a parent, I can
understand.
I couldn't
protect my child.
Sure.
I remember throwing holy water on him while things were hitting him in the head. You could see his head flashing back and forth, but I couldn't stop it. I just could not protect my child, and I did not like that at all.
Now, Denice, I know it's probably for Hollywood, but like with the movie The Sixth Sense, a lot of the time it seemed like the spirits just needed help, either getting a message to somebody or getting closure. Is that what was going on most of the time with Michael? Was he helping these spirits? And when he would break down, would he talk to him?
He actually talked to quite a few. But you got to remember, he was so afraid of the ghosts that the minute they would open their mouths half the time, he would be screaming and running to me.
Right.
I tried to get him, okay, Michael, let's just help some of them so that they would leave us alone. And as long as I was in the room with him, he would talk to them, except for his friend. He had a friend who was hit by a car and was killed.
Right.
He had just left our home and was coming back the next day. I was so frightened to tell Michael that. I was devastated. Michael had a dream that he, or whatever, that he had passed. Well, when Michael came home and I told him that this boy, that best friend had passed,
right.
Michael had told me that he already knew. Now, a few days later, Michael come into the kitchen when I was cooking, and he was so excited, and I'm like, what's the matter? You know, why are you so happy? I never seen Michael happy like he was, and he says he just talked to his friend.
Okay.
I'm like, what? And he told him that he was okay, and that when he didn't feel anything, it was like he was knocked out by playing football, and he thought it was cool to watch everybody work on him. And then told Michael to have his jaw looked at, because there's something wrong with his jaw. And this is what Michael's telling me, and I'm like, okay. And Michael says, I'm not afraid to die. I'm like, okay. He says, it's all okay, Mom. So you never have to worry about dying. I'm like, okay. And he walked away.
Huh.
I think it was about two years. And then something was wrong with Michael's jaw, and he needed, you know, surgery done on his jaw, and they had to take teeth out and all kinds of things.
Wow.
And Michael goes, I told you.
Yeah.
It's like, uh-huh.
So now, John, you brought in Bishop McKenna for this third exorcism. And, you know, the bishop has seen a lot at this point, right?
Absolutely.
He's done Michael's first, too.
He did the first one as well?
Yes, he did.
All right. What are his thoughts coming in for a third round?
Very open.
He knew.
He had no issues with it whatsoever. Absolutely none.
He told me, the bishop told me at the first exorcism, he told me and my husband, actually, to not be surprised if Michael's going to need more. That you know, this could happen.
Okay.
Now, during Michael's first exorcism, I mean, that was, Michael had seen the dark shadow man, is what he calls him, in the left side of the church while he was having the exorcism.
Now, and while Michael, you're having these exorcisms, is it like we're seeing in the movies? Is Michael thrashing about and talking in tongues? And
Is it
just being prayed over and holy water sprinkled on him? And Donny Osmond music in the background?
They had him drink holy water. Michael was very ill. He felt like he was going to throw up. And the bishop had him drink some holy water and stuff. But I'll tell you what, at the end of the exorcism, what I found, what was strange, was I felt a breeze in my face and I smelt roses. And I didn't say anything to Michael or my husband. You know, we're all just sitting there and we're leaving. We get into the car. And the first thing Michael said was, he says, did you feel it and did you smell the roses, Mom? And I was like, yes, I did, you know. And he was quite happy. He said everything seemed brighter to him, you know. And everything when we went home seemed brighter. It's almost like you put on an extra light in the house.
So you think that with this breeze, it was almost like a summer breeze blowing away the bad and refreshing?
I don't know what it was, but it made me feel very loved. I just felt I was overwhelmed. I cried. I just could not stop crying. I was very happy.
Unbelievable. Okay, so you do this third exorcism. And again, these aren't violent, or because he's not actually possessed by anything. You're just trying to cleanse, like, the things that are clinging to him. Is that right, John?
Well, what you have to remember is it's the oppressive state. The oppression state is right before possession.
Right.
And that's where, Dave, I normally will try to get an exorcism performed, because once a person becomes fully possessed, those are the most difficult things to actually break a circumstances like that.
So at this point, you're not trying to get something out of him. You're just trying to close the door so nothing can get into him.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Well, Michael had Larry doing an exorcism actually from his home one morning when I have this on video also. Michael's sitting by the table, and it's not Michael. I don't know who's in my child, but this is not my son. And he's giving me daggers. I mean, he threw a cross and went into the wall. I mean, it's just, I don't know who this kid was.
Wow.
Something was attached to him at that time.
Okay. So once you've accomplished the third exorcism, what happens after that?
At that point in time, that's where decisions had been made, where Denice started looking around, getting and talking to other people, that she had to understand what the procedure was, so to speak. We're trying to be able to teach Michael to learn how to understand some of the things that he was going through. And, you know, the different psychics and mediums and different things I feel that Denice tied in with over the course of the past several years, I think that's shared a lot of information, and I think that brought them to the light of realizing, you know, some of the things basically that I had said to Denice. She actually found out, well, all right, now I know what John's talking about.
Sure.
So, you know, I think a lot of it has opened up for Michael understanding when other people were explaining these things to him also.
Okay. So it was nice repetitive from coming from different sources, so he was actually learning from it.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's learning from it. I think Michael learned a lot on hand experience.
Now, what happens between the third exorcism and the fourth exorcism? Is there more violence? Is there more spirits coming to him? Is there what brings you to the point that you need the fourth and final exorcism?
You know, I think the bishop was the fourth one.
I was just going to say that the bishop was the last one.
The third one was when we were in Florida, and Larry and Debbie flew to Florida and gave him an exorcism.
Okay.
Because that he had one in Florida.
So
and that's when the girl in the bathtub and all the other stuff was.
All right.
Yeah.
So then it's the fourth one is with Bishop McKenna.
Yeah.
Now that you've had the fourth one, how are things in Michael's life?
Like I said, he had that, he stopped being fearful. And the minute Michael kind of realized that he had this gift and it wasn't going to go away, and he had to deal with these things, bloody or not, pretty women in wedding dresses or kids, that he was going to be okay. He realized when the demonic came in, he said that he would just tell them to leave. He would shoot them with his hand, shoot them. So he kind of did it like through his heart and with the white light he learned from people, and they would actually go. A few times he's had an experience where they would mock him or laugh at him, but he's not afraid of them. He feels that he's beyond that now.
Great.
So we're not really too worried about that right now.
All right.
Seeing the spirits every day, well, that's just something that he's going to have to deal with.
You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Our guest this evening is Denice Jones and Mr. John Zaffis. We're talking about a really amazing case of paranormal activity and probably one of the most gifted people out there, loaded with gifts, unfortunately, that I don't think he asked for or was hoping for in life, but is learning to deal with. It's Denise's son, Michael, who sees dead people and was actually the person that was the basis for the character played by Haley Joel Osment in the movie The Sixth Sense. We'll be back with more right after this.
We thought El Chupacabra meant the cup of coffee in Spanish.
Me llamo Eduardo Especial. ¿Cómo está el yay?
What you talking about, Willis?
Shows you what we know. Stay tuned. There's more to come from the darkness on the edge of town.
If you, read Taps Paramag every month, you'll be able to tell the difference between the absurd.
Could not go to work because Bigfoot stole my car.
And the creepy. Taps Paramag takes you where few would ever go on purpose. From exclusive interviews with the cast of The Ghost Hunters to the latest trends in technology in the field of the paranormal. To join our journey, order at tapsparamag.com.
The smell of voodoo hangs in the air. Either that or Dave and Tim had the seven bean salad for dinner.
Don't nobody go in the bathroom for about 35, 45 minutes. Somebody open the window.
Welcome back to the darkness, or whatever is hanging in the air, on the edge of town.
Good evening and welcome back to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. I'm your host, Dave Schrader, along with me as always, my co-host and silent partner, Tim. We've got, he's waving at you. We've got on the line with us this evening, we've got John Zaffis, a paranormal investigator and demonologist. John has been in the field forever. He's been involved in a lot of great cases, got some interesting books out. Please check out his website at johnzaffis.com. And along with John this evening, we have Denice Jones. She's the founder of the Life Foundation, and you can get more information about Denice, her amazing family, and her foundation by going to paranormalhelp.com. We've been talking to them about the case involving her son, Michael, who can see dead people and has been dealing with demonic presences and spirits and so on and so forth. And we've just kind of gotten past the fourth exorcism that her son had to endure, and now he's growing and understanding his abilities and powers. So I have to ask then, Denice, so what is he doing with these gifts?
Right now?
Yeah.
Nothing.
Ah, excellent. Like most teenagers.
Yeah, he's going to wait a little while. Actually, I had somebody from England, a TV show, contact us down there. They want to pay to have Michael go to the Arthur Findlay School in England, and they would pay for him to stay there and learn his gift. Michael is going to wait maybe another year, he says. He wants to, you know, make some money and, you know, live his life a little bit.
Sure.
Before he does, you know, takes that big plunge of going into another country.
Okay. All right. So, but he's just kind of taking it easy. I mean, is he still being plagued by demonic problems? I know you said he can kind of,
he can get rid of them now. Sometimes they come in, but he gets rid of them, pretty much. He sees the spirits every day. That's just normal.
John, what do you think about this case? I mean, is this one of the more dramatic or just insane cases that you've been a part of?
With certain cases, you get personally involved. And it's a type of situation where Denice and I became buddies.
Sure.
And at that, with that, that makes it more personal. So you do look at the dynamics, you look at the situations a little bit differently than you would with other situations. But the intriguing part when it comes into Michael is the aspect of knowing that he probably has the capabilities of several different areas with mediumship and, you know, the astral projection and the other elements that tie in with all that. So, you know, you got a combo of a lot of the different things. And I realized that way back when I got involved with it. And I said to myself, that's something that's going to prove out interesting in the future with Michael to see how he develops.
Now, what do you feel, you know, from what you've learned and see that this boy is capable of doing, John, what do you believe this boy's purpose here is?
Well, with these types of situations, Dave, like with Mike, is there a purpose and an intent to be able to help spirit to cross over? Yeah. And I feel the abilities are very strong on that level with Michael. And I've told Denice this many times. I said, when Michael gets older, I says, and he fine-tunes his skills, I says, he'll probably be helping a lot of spirits to be able to cross over. He'll probably be able to bring people answers that they've been looking for different things. So his purpose probably is on that level of communicating and helping spirit and helping us mortals to kind of connect all the dots and help out.
Okay. Now you guys have you've gotten through all this with Michael. He's gone through all of these changes and all of these developments of different abilities and skills. And right now he's just kind of taking it easy and backing off. I mean, what, if anything, was the most frightening, do you think, for Michael to have to deal with, Denice? I mean, through all of these crazy situations that have popped up, what's been the most frightening thing that he's had to deal with so far?
God, he's been frightened so much. I think when he was scratched a lot, when they would scratch him, like when he'd go into the shower and he'd get claw marks,
sure,
that drew blood, you know, I think that was very frightening. Or when he's in the paralyzed state, I think that was pretty frightening for him because he could hear and he knew everything that was going on around him, but he couldn't come out.
Well, talk to us a little bit more about that. What exactly is it that he can do with this out-of-body experiences? What's happening to him? Where is he going? Is he getting answers from somewhere? Is he floating over the Colosseum?
Everywhere.
What's he doing?
Well, you know, I think the first thing he ever told me when it first happened to him was he had popped out and he found himself in a church, and he just kept going fast towards the front, and there was a man with long gray hair sitting there in the front pew, and he just never turned around. And Michael was frightened because he was going towards him, and that was it. He ended up popping back in. Michael, he doesn't know where he's going. It just happens. He could be watching TV, and if he gets comfortable enough, his spirit wants to come out.
Okay. Now,
I think I called John one time for that because Michael was going crazy. I mean, we had to keep rubbing his legs to keep him in. I don't know if you remember that, John.
Yeah,
here
I remember
at this house.
Yeah.
And he just kept, you know, he'd pace the floors because if he sat down or relaxed, he would come out.
What do you believe that this ability, what is this trying to teach him or instill in him?
I have no clue.
Concept on that's astral projection.
Right.
And it's a good possibility. Is it trying to teach him the ability that these things do occur and these things do happen with him? Absolutely. That is a classic sign of it. Now, a key factor, too, when some of these types of things occur with people, they get very cold. And it's not just their hands or their feet or their head. Their entire body gets very ice cold. That's another indication that tells me that there is something occurring on a paranormal level when this occurs.
All right, so you think that it's, I don't know, just that he's learning that there's other things out there? You don't feel it?
Yeah, I think Michael had to learn all these gifts because he has so many of them that it just happens. These things just happen, and he has to learn and get through them.
Well, do you think that, you know, he keeps fighting it? Do you think maybe he should just let go and see where it takes him, and maybe there's an ultimate truth that he's being pulled towards?
Well, that's what happened. When Michael lost his fear and gave, you know, just was like, okay, I'm not going to be afraid anymore. I'm going to let it happen. That's when Michael started living his life.
Okay.
He was able to, you know, when he gets up, he still sleeps with his light on. I mean, Michael, he has to have a light on, but he can sleep in his room. You know, I don't have to be run upstairs every half hour because he's screaming.
Right. Well, how old is Michael now?
Michael is 18. He'll be 19 in next month.
Okay. Now, does he, you know, I know you said he's come to terms with these things. He's not afraid of it. Letting himself go. Have you guys considered having him not psychologically tested, but, you know, where they can set up the brain receptors to check if he's actually in a form of sleep when he goes into this state. I mean, there's got to be some kind of change that's going on.
Yeah, well, he's had what they called Mickey fins, where they put electrodes to his head and all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
He's had a lot of that work done. He's had a lot of tests and stuff. They all just stay the same to just get psychic help. Michael's gifted. The hospital here in Manchester have it that there is a boy who really sees ghosts, and when he goes to the hospital, I mean, everybody starts whispering, and Michael's a little embarrassed by it. Still, he's still at a young enough age to be a little embarrassed.
Now, has he had the opportunity to meet with Bruce Willis or M. Night Shyamalan or Haley Joel Osment at all about any of the stuff that they did in the movies?
No, and I don't think he would want to. He doesn't seem to want to deal with anybody but certain people, like John. He loves John. You know, he feels safe with John. He feels a little ashamed. Like it's, you know, he got beat up in school all the time from it and things like that. He had a hard life. I mean, the kid.
Sure.
You know, he's trying to just wants to live a little bit. He knows that he has to do what he has to do when it comes to these gifts, but he just begs for just a few years or a year off, you know, before he has to, you know, go into it.
Now, is he helping spirits that are coming to him? Is he helping them to cross over or complete their mission here or whatever reason they have for talking to him?
I would say in the last year and a half, he has spoken to some, and I've helped him guide them to the light, so to speak, because he said he feels safe when I'm there, and I would help him.
Okay,
so he has helped a few.
All right. So just in the last year, or has he been doing it ever since he was a child now?
No, he was too afraid to talk to them.
Okay.
He was very scared. I mean, sure. When he would see them, he would scream.
All right, well, let's kind of launch forward then. This has developed a friendship, obviously, between the two of you, John and Denice. So, Denice, people come to you for help with other cases. Is that how you're calling John in on other cases, or has John called you in, how exactly have you two, you know, continued to work with one another outside of this?
I think a lot of cases that came into the Life Foundation, I would call up John, and he would say, "You want to go?" And we would go.
So you go with on these investigations as well, Denice. What do you see when you go to these places? I mean, are there other cases or other children like Michael out there that you've run into yet?
I have through the Life Foundation. I'm sure John has too. I haven't to the degree that Michael has, but there are many gifted children out there.
John, do you believe that this is something new? This ability, I mean, not new, I know it's been around forever, but that there seems to be more and more children that are popping up with this type of ability and, you know, special powers, if you will?
No, I don't think it's anything new whatsoever. I just feel that it's more appropriate, or people are more comfortable today talking about these types of situations. It's not an unusual thing, Dave. You know, through my organization, I deal with a ton of these kids. And it's not anything new to me to deal with this type of thing. It's just that now, due to the exposure, due to everything that is opened and things that are talked about, parents look at it a little bit differently.
So it's almost like, you know, in the past, presidents cheated on their wives and did things, but nobody talked about it. And
exactly.
Now they're doing the same thing they did back then, but now the media and everybody doesn't have any qualms about reporting on it or talking about it, so it's just become more available to people.
Absolutely.
What do you think, Jen, when I say the word indigo children? Is that what this is?
Well, you know, that's a very popular term for that.
Right.
And I actually am dealing with two families right now. They refer to their children as indigo children.
Give us a quick explanation so that the listeners know. I mean, I've got mine, but I don't, you know, I never seem to be a full grasp of the explanation. What exactly is an indigo child?
My explanation of it is basically the same thing. It's a very gifted and very psychic child. They believe that, you know, here again, they can pick up on the spirit. and they communicate with them, and it is believed that it has to do with just about everything that we talk about as just a gifted child. It's okay. The same thing. It's just really basically a different term, and it seems that people are comfortable with that term, and they look at it a little bit lighter, calling them an indigo child, than they do any other way.
And saying that their psychic abilities or
right.
things, okay.
Same exact thing.
Well, between the two of you now, other cases that you've gone on, we always like to kind of, in the last segment or here or two, and we're going to cut to a commercial break in a minute, we'll come back, but I'd like you both to kind of kick around. I always like to kind of give a little scare, especially because we're closer to Halloween here, and I'd like to hear, well, you know, one of the weirder or creepier cases you two have worked on, or two, if you've got enough time for them, since you've paired up together to do these type of events. We'd like to hear a little bit more about that. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. Our guests this evening are Denice Jones, founder of the Life Foundation at ParanormalHelp.com, and also John Zaffis, the paranormal investigator and demonologist. You can check out his information at JohnZaffis.com. We'll be back more with our guests right after this.
It will keep you on the edge of your seat.
I must have drank me about 15 Dr. Peppers.
I gotta pay.
Just don't get any on the floor. Hurry back. There is more to come from the darkness on the edge of town.
Do you want to take charge of your life? We all have our demons we want to get rid of. This is Russ Clark. My hypnosis CD series will help you take charge of your life and kick those demons out. Thousands of people have made personal improvements through the power of hypnosis. Your success is guaranteed by me, or I will refund 100% of your investment. To kick those demons or to add relaxation into your life, visit my website, www.powerhypnosis.net.
Ahoy, shiver me timbers!
Excuse me, Captain.
Who said that?
I did.
And this is a mutiny.
A mutiny?
Yes. We need to have some fun. And what could be more fun than taking some time to go to Trail of Terror?
What?
Trail of Terror, Captain. There are live bands, a DJ, and more activities than you can shake my bony finger at.
Oh.
Trail of Terror runs Thursdays through Sunday evening starting October 12th to the 29th and Halloween with a special extra night on October 18th. Trail of Terror, Pirate's Plunder is located 3 miles south of Shakopee on Highway 169 and Highway 41. Free parking is provided by Burnsville Toyota.
Leave me alone!
Do you have
bows?
Do you have dreams?
Do you have an interest in the unknown? Want to know more about the paranormal? Come and join us in Para Investigators, the 24/7 online paranormal chat. Visit us today at InfinityParanormal.com and tell us what's been keeping you up in the dark.
Ghosts, goblins, witches, creatures of the night. Yep, that just about covers everybody Dave and Tim have ever dated.
Oh my God, this girl's really turning me on.
Welcome back to the darkness on the edge of town.
Good evening and welcome back to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. My guests tonight have been Denice Jones from the Life Foundation. You can reach for her for help at ParanormalHelp.com. And Mr. John Zaffis, the paranormal investigator, godfather of soul, hardest working man in the industry. And, that's right. You can reach him by going to JohnZaffis.com. That's Z-A-F-F-I-S, JohnZaffis.com. And look for their help there. Let's go. Before we get into your final stories, I just want to mention, while Tim and I were on during the commercial break here, we just had kind of a strange little phenomenon as we're talking, waiting here, and we could hear John and Denice talking back and forth. All of a sudden, we heard them, what we assumed was Denice whispering to John about something, and I asked him what they were whispering about, and Denice just informed us she wasn't whispering, and neither was John. So Tim and I just basically over the headphones heard, coming over our headphones. So we're a little weirded out. So if suddenly you hear the microphone swing and the headphones hit the ground and we're out of here, you know somebody's talking in our ears. But let's get back into real quick. Let's see what's going on in your worlds to promote. Is there anything you want to talk about? And then we'll get into the final spooky story that you've got here. John, why don't we start off with you?
Okay, basically, check out my website. I am lecturing at a lot of the campuses and universities all over the place. My book, Shadows of the Dark, is definitely available on Amazon.com. Working on my second book, The Struggle Within, and hopefully that's going to be released sometime this fall. Just got done working on a movie segment for Spooky Kids and working on a couple of episodes for Haunted. I will be on the History Channel talking about exorcisms. That will be airing in the fall also. Several different paranormal radio shows and
I can't believe
what?
That. You do other radio shows?
Yes, sir.
John, what a disappointment.
Sir.
We have to start seeing a counselor or something. All right. And Denice, how about you? What's going on in your world?
Well, I'm working on two books, sequels to The Other Side with Jason Mercury from The Ghost Magazine, and a book with Diane Gonzalez from Osprey. Please Don't Close the Door. It's about children in spirit and how to help and deal with that.
Okay, and what can they, if people are looking for help, what kind of help can they find going to paranormalhelp.com?
Well, my foundation is like a referral service. When I was dealing with all the stuff, I happened to come across investigators that weren't there to help us. They were there to help themselves. So the foundation, I put together investigators throughout the world, influential ones, where if they need help, I can refer them to someone in their own state and town where they can get help.
Okay, great. So if you have problems, you can go to a reputable paranormal investigator that's not just there to prove to themselves that there's such a thing as ghosts and be freaked out and go home and tell their buddies a good story. You're actually
somebody
sending
who's actually going to help.
Okay, excellent. That's important. And people can go there, and they all have to do is go to paranormalhelp.com, and you're right on there, correct?
Yes.
All right. Well, let's go. We'll wrap up. Is there anything else you wanted to mention? Any other programs or deals you're working on right now? The Sixth Sense 2, Michael's Revenge?
Well, we're waiting for that, but got to wait for the second book to come out first.
Okay.
I have to wait for that.
All right. Well, then let's go in. I asked before we left for the break here. We've got about 15 minutes left. Let's hear the juiciest, creepiest story you've got that you guys have worked on together.
I want Denice to go on this one. Her and I traveled down to Tennessee to go work on a very wicked haunting.
Yeah.
And the people were plagued like I couldn't believe. And I'm going to let Denice tell this story.
Okay.
She tells it better than me.
All right.
Okay.
Go ahead,
he thinks so. Yeah, a case came into Life Foundation, and it was this man, and they needed help. It was really haunted, they said. And so me and John, we flew to Tennessee, and we go into the home. Well, I remember sitting there at the table, and John's asking questions to these people, and next thing you know, something grabs me. And I mean, it grabs me in an area that nobody should be grabbing me. And
oh,
I.
My. Okay.
Just her husband.
Just my husband. That's it.
All right.
And I jumped
up. Or the pool boy, Marcus?
Yes. I have a nice pool.
Oh, okay.
But not a pool boy.
Okay.
Oh, I told John, I said, get outside, we need to talk now. And we went outside and talked. I told him what had happened. He went in and talked to the guy alone. And I don't know how much I can say on the radio.
Oh, go ahead, because, you know, we'll just beep it. Nobody listens to our show anyway, so it's okay. No, go
it's
ahead.
Only us here.
That's right.
And what happened on this case that we were going to be spending the night at the house, which we didn't stay, the man was allowing things to sexually touch him. And then he allowed them to touch his wife and children while he watched.
Yikes.
And we didn't know it was this serious of a case. And we were, like, thrown in into Tennessee, you know, far away from home, on a case that just...
Who called you in on this case?
I think it was actually the wife.
Yes, it was.
I think it was the wife. She was saying the husband was having troubles And sure, he was having troubles. He was in the wife and the children. Nobody knew what was going on.
Now, John, is this a form of a succubus or incubus?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
You know, here again, when you're interviewing people and you're talking to them, a lot of times you don't get down to the bottom of a situation until you're on site. And there was just too much that was occurring and too much that wasn't lining up for this case. And as I interviewed him and I was talking to him, it dawned on me on some of the situations that were occurring that this person was bringing this forth and that he was actually enjoying these types of situations.
So was he actually allowing this to masturbate him to a full orgasm, or just fondling him, or what was he doing? I mean,
the whole nine yards.
Oh yeah, everything. Yeah.
You name it, and this gentleman was allowing all types of sexual occurrences to take place with him, and he did not reveal all that during our emails or telephone conversations with him. But when I finally got him on one-on-one speaking to him in regards to some of these things, I realized what he was doing after dealing with people like that and confronted him. And I said, you're basically bringing this forward and you're letting this occur within your home. I said, I know exactly what you're doing. And at that point in time, that's when activity basically had kicked up and no one knew in the other room where Denice was and the other family members, but those people started having experiences in the other room, including Denice.
All right, now, can you give us, what is a definition, a full definition of a succubus and an incubus? Those are basically just demonic-type spirits that sexually gratify themselves with you, or?
Okay, incubus and succubus, basically they have no gender. They take that upon, depending on whether us mortals are male or female.
Okay.
They will basically do the sexual acts with men or with women, and it depends on how far some of these situations go with people. Sometimes it's very tormenting, it's very degrading, especially with women. Guys look at it a little bit differently. And,
so are they actually, I'm sorry, I don't mean to be graphic on this, but I mean, are they actually having sexual intercourse with these spirits?
It doesn't necessarily, it can happen, but that's rare. Usually it is the act of the penetration with a female, and it is actually the act of where it could be a female with the male. It's more of an act than it is the actual the sensations are there. The act of it is there, but there isn't anything actual physical happening.
Okay.
Right.
All right. So now you're separated in two different rooms. You're talking to this goofball who's allowing himself and his family to be sexually molested. At this point, have you talked to the wife? Is the wife jiving on this too? Is she enjoying the side action, or is this just the husband being a wackadoo?
Well, the woman was completely innocent.
She didn't know about it.
She was not even aware of what was happening.
She wasn't aware she was being penetrated?
No, she wasn't aware of the haunting, of what was exactly occurring from the husband's perspective, on what he was doing.
Okay.
She was totally in the dark in regards to all that. All she knew is that there was something happening in her home. She was being attacked. Her children were having experiences, and she couldn't understand why it was happening or where it was coming from. But she was well aware of it after we were there.
But he would sit there and watch her be molested or raped by a spirit?
Was he? Yes.
Yes.
And she knew that he was watching this?
I don't think she was aware of it.
She wasn't aware of it. She was, it was like she was in some kind of state.
Unreal.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
and the children. Children were young. Mm.
Now you've separated this, John. I mean, and what's happening to you and the other people, Denice? What's going on? You're all being groped or what?
I was being very groped. Yeah, I couldn't believe it. You know, and it was funny because it was the only home that I went into that I did not guard myself with the white light. I did, and I have no idea why. And it was the first thing I said to John, oh, my God, I didn't guard myself. I didn't prepare myself. I did not expect that to be happening.
So how did you do? I mean, so you're being groped in front of these people. Could they see this happening to you? Or are you just trying to sit there and keep your cool?
Oh, I'm trying to keep my cool. Absolutely, I'm trying to at that point get rid of it, guard myself.
Are you talking out loud, or are you just kind
of
visualizing the white light and praying in your head and asking for help? And is that working?
Oh yes, it worked.
Okay, all right. So the spirit backs off from you, and then does he begin accosting other people in the room? Or it?
I think it was the wife who was touched.
All right.
And I think she was touched outside by the car. And this is when John was inside the house talking to the man.
All right. So, John, you've talked to this guy. You realize that he's kind of a sicko.
Mm.
Now, is he sick or is he possessed by something that's allowing him to enjoy this weirdness?
It's not even that he's exactly possessed, or I would call him more of a type of person that he discovered that he could use these energies and he can use these particular demons and manipulate them to do things to other people around him. And it was just his fetish and what he was into. And he had this whole other life, like we hear so many times that people are into, that the partner's not even aware of.
That's right. Yeah.
So, you know, in the midstream of this, during the end of my conversation, I had said to him, I says, I hope you do realize that I will be telling your wife everything you just informed me of. And to be honest with you, he was outraged. He told me I did not have a right to interfere in that. And I told him, I said, you people brought me in. You're asking for my honest opinion. And I says, you have four little children out there. I says, she has a right to know that.
Wow. So what was the outcome of this? Did you spend the night there?
No.
No.
No, it was it was way too risky. What he was calling upon, and after me confronting him, that would have put Denice and myself in too much of a vulnerable situation.
Sure. Did you separate them, the family, then? You told the wife. What was her reaction there?
She had to contemplate some of this. This was an awful lot to inform her of. She felt she was living with somebody for many years that she never even knew.
She ended up divorcing him.
Yes.
But did she stay there that night?
To be honest with you, if I remember correctly, I don't think she did.
No, she didn't. She went to her mother's.
Yes.
And took the children, I hope. Okay.
The children.
So, yeah, well, I don't blame you, John. I guess, I mean, if he can conjure these things to molest people, conjuring them to do you or Denice any harm would probably not be a hard thing to do.
That was already in works, and that was already planned out after I confronted him.
Oh, that was part of it? Was he was planning on when you guys were there to have these spirits molest you or do you harm?
To let us know that the spirit was there, people will do things like this to prove to you that there's something there.
Right.
It's just that he wasn't expecting me to put the puzzle together.
He thought
on
he was
exactly
just showing
what
off.
He was doing.
Okay.
Very quickly. Yeah, because we did that pretty quick, too, going into that house.
All right. And what had it touched you or bothered you at all, John?
No, I was not sexually touched in any way, shape, or form. There was an extremely heaviness. But the only thing I remember was the fact that towards the end, when we were getting ready to leave and everything, you felt it starting to build within there. And I remember Denice looked at me, and she had said to me, she goes, John, we cannot stay here. And I says, no. I said, my mind was already made up on that. And I says, we're probably going to be better off leaving as soon as we possibly can.
Wow. How often are you called into a case, John, where you get there and you realize that you're in over your head?
Many times.
Mm-hmm.
Many,
right.
Many times. You know, we get involved, Dave, going in. I do go in very skeptical. I always have and I always will, because you can tell me anything you want on the phone or send me an email. It doesn't mean I'm going to believe it.
Right.
But when you go in and these types of situations are as hardcore as they could possibly be, it's a pretty frightening experience. One case I investigated last year, I had no clue the intensity of the situation. Showed up with several of the investigators that worked with me, and we were sitting doing the interview, and the gentleman was telling me about how he was being sexually attacked, he's being thrown around, and this young lady comes in, and she goes to sit down at the table, and she decided she was going to interview me. So she's sitting there asking me many questions and basically had said, I know who you are. And I looked at her and I says, well, you do? And she was going back and forth and she goes, we will have you by morning. And I said, I don't think so. Well, there was a couple of new people with me and we were going back and forth with this conversation. And she says, it's time for you to join us. And I'm looking at the couple of people that are with me. They're panic-stricken, and they didn't know what to do. So I was like, okay, at this point, because I go through these types of things, I had said to them, I said, it's time to pack the equipment up and we have to leave. Well, the parents of the young boy were there. Nobody could make heads or tails of what was going on. The mother comes outside with me, and she goes, I don't know what to make of this. She goes, but that young lady has something to do with what my son is going through. And I went, yeah. I said, she's into hardcore stuff, and she's bringing this forth. And I says, this is a very, very dangerous situation. And she screams from within the house, I need your blood. I want his blood. So the mother and I are standing there. We ran back in the house, and I'm thinking it was the son she was referring to. We walk in, and she's in the kitchen. The boy and a couple of other people were standing to the side. And I looked at the boy, and I says, don't do anything she tells you. She turned, and she looked at me, and she goes, you mother effer, it's not his blood I want. It's yours.
Wow.
And I said at that point in time, I says, I think it'd be a very wise choice for everybody to leave. Dave, you never seen people vacate a house so fast in your life. I mean, the equipment was packed up and in that car, and they were right there waiting for me before I even had a chance to turn around and look to see where they were. The mom got the son. She got two of his friends. They vacated the house. She called me about 2 weeks later. I had placed two calls, did not hear back from her. She had called me back, and she said the events were so bad, we had to call the police in. The woman was screaming about what she conjured up and that you had screwed everything up.
Wow.
And that you ruined everything. And she said, I didn't even know how to approach you about any of this, John. I said, you should have called me right away. And I says, where's the young lady right now? She goes, John, she was in jail. Then they decided that they were going to institutionalize her afterwards because now is all she does is keep screaming about the demons and how everything got messed up.
Well, John, thank you for effectively scaring the living out of my listeners tonight.
Hey, John likes to scare people.
That's right. Well, John, thank you very much for joining us this evening. Denice, I can't thank you very much or enough for sharing your story and your son's story with us tonight. And we'd like to follow back up with you in the future, find out more about what's going on with you and your son. And again, for people that are interested in getting in touch with Denice, if you're having issues with the paranormal and you need help, you can find her at paranormalhelp.com. For John Zaffis, you can check him at johnzaffis.com. You're listening to the Darkness on the Edge of Town Paranormal Radio Show. We'll be back with you next week with a brand new show.